good morning, friends. And good morning to any of you who might be joining us online today. Because of current restrictions, there's just a small group of family gathered in our church sanctuary right now, and we gather to remember and celebrate the life of Keith Bart. So on behalf of Linda and Keith's children and larger family, thank you for joining us today if you're participating online. It's a rather simple service. We're going to do some basic things. We'll have some music together, and you just heard a piece. Again, if you're watching online, it might be a little soft. We just have a Bluetooth speaker here in the sanctuary. But then to open, I'd like to read a little scripture for us, and then I'll pray for us. We'll have a little more music, and then there'll be a time of remembering where anyone gathered here who would like to share something, a memory or something about Keith, you'd be welcome to do that. And then I'll have just a brief thought to share from the Bible on some verses of Scripture, and then we'll close. So as we come to this, we come believing that all of our stories are wrapped up in a larger story, the story of Jesus. And Keith did not live his life to him alone. He lived his story under a much larger story. So in that sense, we come also to worship God. So as we come, can I read some Scripture for us to begin? One of my favorite verses from Proverbs chapter 3. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to him and he will make your paths straight. And this from the prophet Isaiah. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men will stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. And these are things that Jesus said when he was with us in person. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. He said this too. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives, meaning he doesn't give it and then take it back. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. And then finally this, Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die, and whoever lives by believing in me will never die. In our little part of the Christian tradition, we have a teaching tool called a catechism. It helps people kind of learn what the Christian faith is all about, and it's in a question and answer format. And I've always appreciated the first question and answer. It's so basic and so helpful. The question is this: what is your only comfort in life and in death? And the answer is this: that I am not my own, but belong body and soul in life and in death to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. He has fully paid for all my sins with his precious blood and has set me free from the tyranny of the devil. He also watches over me in such a way that not a hair can fall from my head without the will of my Father in heaven. In fact, all things must work together for my salvation. Because I belong to him, Christ, by his Holy Spirit, assures me of eternal life and makes me wholeheartedly willing and ready from now on to live for him. Would you pray with me? God, as we gather today, we again acknowledge that we do so with a whole variety of feelings. We come to you, God, feeling sad and grieving. We come to you with some memories that probably make us laugh and bring joy. Some memories that might bring more pain than joy and might prompt us more toward tears. So, God, we offer all of that to you and pray that you would be with us in it. And as we gather to remember and share stories of Keith's life and to celebrate him and the person you made him to be, we pray that you would be with us, God, and turn our hearts and minds toward you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We pray in your name. Amen. We're going to spend some time now remembering Keith's life, and I think Keith's son Kevin is going to lead off, and Kirk, I think, will wrap up. But between them, if anyone else would like to share something, please just come forward and grab one of the mics and feel free. Kevin.
Hello. And that's what my dad would always do. I'm wearing one of my dad's shirts today. He liked Hawaiian shirts. This one's a little small, I think, but I don't know, maybe it shrunk, Linda? Did some of these shrink or something? No, they're a little tight. But and this beads too, I'm not sure the significance of what they mean, but he liked to wear them, didn't he? He loved Hawaii. So I'll just say a few things. I mean, we've all been thinking and a lot of memories come through our minds the last few days, right? Some good, some not so good. I kind of wanted to bring up, maybe we should edit, do a little editing on some of those memories, right? Just kind of, some of the stuff, we just won't focus on that. And that's what Jesus does in our life, actually. He edits, but he erases through his son. But a couple things we could edit out for Dad once in a while, but he loved food, right? We all do, I suppose. But I just wrote down Mr. Fables. You know, he loved working there. Greg knows I make Fables burgers on Wednesday nights, or used to. But, and I worked there. Kim worked there. Lynn worked there. Lynn's mom, brother, sister. Anybody else? No. But we love Fables, and we still talked about it up, you know, a lot. So, and he, we found a mayonnaise that's close to Fables. It's called Duke's Mayo. You can buy it at Walmart and probably D&W. But I told him about it, and he, that's good, that's good. And somebody on Facebook said, yeah, Duke's uses vinegar, and Fable's original recipe had lemon juice in it, and which it, actually it did. But Dad said, well, how do you know what the secret recipe was on Facebook? Well, how do you know what the secret recipe is? Oh, I just thought that was funny. But chili dogs, I wrote down chili dogs because he loved, well, yesterdog when they were good. But now it's too dirty to go in there, he said. So, but he found, there was a place called One Bun. Do you remember that? Kirk and I and Dad went there a lot. They're gone now, too. But and then Cook's Drive-In out in Dutton. Loved Cook's. But I don't think he went there anymore because they charged him extra for extra cheese or something one time, or he wanted extra chili on it, and they were going to charge him, and he walked out. But his shrimp cookouts, remember the shrimp cookouts? And we found some of those utensils the other day, too, but the big pot of shrimp, and I think Kirk made it once, but we'll have to pass that recipe down and keep it going, right? That was good. Daryl and Nancy remember those shrimp cookouts. On 43rd Street, weren't they? Was he doing them then? Yep. Orange cream, I got written down here. He'd put orange cream ice cream in a glass of orange pop. He would. He loved it. And I eat orange cream taffy all the time, and I like orange too. I guess a few things got passed down. That's why this shirt's a little tight. The shrimp. Oh, the gravy, beef gravy on Sundays. He didn't have lumps in it, I tell you that. And Mom didn't make the gravy after a couple years. So he showed me how to make the gravy. And when I do that meal here on Wednesdays or at home, I make it like Dad does. No lumps. And he used Wondra, right? I sometimes use flour, but I never told him. But food was a big part of our family, and that's how God intended it, I think. I loved his laugh, though. He'd kind of, you know, I love to make him laugh. I just love that. And, you know, when we get together for birthdays or the holidays, just saying a one-liner, you know, get him to kind of, you know, do a little chuckle. But I just love that. And to see him smile, I can remember it. Yep. Sure can. There he is in that Hawaiian shirt. Did you guys see that picture online? He's got a big birthday cake on his lap. That's the nicest smile I've ever seen him have. And it was a good cake, too. He had a piece about like that. But I love to make him laugh and to see him laugh. But he cried a little bit too. You know, he had a tough life, especially these last few years. His calendar, we saw, was full of something every day. Every day. Going here, got to go get a test, got to go get an x-ray, got to go. You know, he was weary of that. But we got together on his birthday, September 13. I think that was the day, wasn't it? It was Sunday, yep. And you wouldn't know it, really. I mean, you wouldn't know what he was going through. And frankly, I didn't know everything, you know. But we laughed. We had cake and ice cream, and we talked to Penny that day, right? He got to FaceTime Penny in Texas, and he had that shirt on. And yeah, his son's got a couple nice smiles up there too, I guess. But I can't read my own. Oh, well, I won't have to do any more network marketing. So that's all right. I don't have to buy all these books and CDs. Go to meetings. Yeah, oh, I've been to a lot of marketing meetings, believe me. We would travel to go to network marketing meetings. But yeah, he just liked it. You know, I think why he liked it so much, because of people. It was a people business. You know, you get to network with people, really, and you get to talk to people and share stories, and that's why he probably loved it so much. And of course, we got hunting stories, right, Daryl? We used to hunt when I was probably 12 years old when we hunted up north in Tustin. And one time, two big bucks were out there fighting, you know, and I was in a tree stand, probably 12 years old, and they were fighting. We were watching them. I forget where Daryl and Dad were, but they came down right by me, like right where that ramp is from here. Oh, I was in Dad's? Oh, yeah, whoops. But anyway, I shot all my arrows and missed it. It was a big, I mean, it was probably an 18 point or something. It was huge. I missed them all. And Dad came over. Did you see that deer? Did you see that buck? I'm like, yeah, it went right down here. And he said, well, did you shoot at it? I said, yeah, I shot at it. Did you hit it? No. But that was fun. And I had buck fever coming out of my ears, man. I was probably like this, you know, shooting the bow. But we had a lot of good times up there at Helmer's. Helmer was the old guy. We stayed at his house and hunted. And it was cold. He didn't have good heat. But Dad brought warm sleeping bags and made sure. I mean, it was a big deal to him. And hunting was. And mushroom hunting even, you know. I mean, when he could, we went mushroom hunting. And those things were, here's one. He'd holler at us to come over, and sure enough, we'd find a bunch of them there. He went to the 84 World Series when the Tigers won. He liked that. He came back with a piece of sod from the stadium. I don't know how he got that. I don't remember that story. And then, yeah, we went to the Golden Gloves quite often. With Daryl recently, we were going to go this year, but then, they canceled it all. But I hope you guys can all share memories too today. But, you know, he'd say to me, I'm proud of you, son. That's what he'd say. You know, when I did something, I'm proud of you, son. That's son. He called me son. I'm proud of you, son. And I do that with my boys. But that's who he was. He loved us all. Everyone here he loved. But I'll just pass it on to my kids. I'm proud of you, son. Okay? All right. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Mike Bart. For those of you that don't know me, I am, and I will say emphatically, the youngest of the three Bart brothers. So I'm going to take you back to a time when Keith and my brother Craig were fairly young, and this was a story that my dad used to love to tell about the two of them. We grew up on Bates Street, went to First Christian Reformed Church, and back in that time, used to have something called family visitation. There's a few chuckles from the audience, I appreciate that. So what family visitation was, the pastor generally and one of the elders from the church came over to your house, and you sat and had coffee and had some conversations, and whatever the ultimate purpose of that was, I'm not sure, but you know, we don't have that tradition today, so we'll let that be a judgment on that. But at any rate, the pastor and the elder had come in, and my mom and dad greeted them and had the coffee going, and Keith and Craig were around, and they met the two twins, and that time of greeting was done, and one of the, either the pastor or the elder, gave my two oldest brothers a pack of gum, and off to the bedroom they went so that they could have a conversation with my parents. Well, as the conversation was going with my parents and not too far into it, all of a sudden a big expletive deleted came out of the bedrooms where the two twins were. And there was a deafening silence in the living room. My dad jumped up, stormed into the bedroom, and as he tells the story, Keith and Craig were rumbling around on the bedroom floor, fighting each other. My dad said, "What in the world is going on here?" And Keith looked up and said, pointed at Craig and said, "He took the extra piece of gum." So that's one of my early stories about Craig that I, or Keith and Craig that I wanted to share today. Thank you.
Good morning, I'm Doug Bart. I'm the middle of the Bart boys. And I'm feeling a little bit remiss because when Keith went to Craig's funeral and he spoke, he did an eloquent job of talking about his big brother. And I promise you that for your children, for his children, I'll write down in the next few days my memories of your father and my big brothers. I go way back with those two Jamokes. I think my earliest memory of them was on a Sunday morning, we were gonna go to church. And Mother had come up with a couple of sailor suits for Keith and Craig. And I'm being a little jealous about this, because I got some old, probably blue jeans or whatever, and here's my big brothers in these really cool navy suits, and they had navy buttons on them, the whole nine yards. Then growing up with those two, even as 4, 5, and 6 years old, we would go anywhere, and of course those cute little twins got all the attention. Then the three of us kind of bonded a little bit, and I thought, I'm the different one here, I'm the good one, okay? So that went on for a long time, and they were great swimmers. I can remember hating to go to the swim meets every Friday night because it was hot in there. And I said to my dad one time, I said, "Dad, why do we have to go watch these things?" And he said, "Well, because it's your big brothers, and that's a family thing." I said, "But Dad, it's a waste of time." He said, "What do you mean?" I said, "Well, every time they get ready to swim, I know who's going to win the race. This is boring. I don't want to do this. So they were great swimmers. It made me swim, but I didn't quite have that one. The only thing I could do is I could outrun those guys. So I don't ever remember having a fight with either one of them, okay? I might not have been too bright, but I was not stupid enough to fight with them. The other thing that's kind of cool, we grew up in the ghetto, and because I was the little guy, I was kind of a big mouth with all the neighbors that tried to intimidate us. And the only reason I dared do that is I got these two of those to take care of me. I can remember one time at Franklin Park, three people were trying to steal my bike. And I ran over there, and obviously they kicked the snot out of me and took my bike and left. So Keith says to me, "Well, we got to go to Franklin Park tomorrow afternoon and get your bike back." I said, "Ooh, I don't know about that. These guys are pretty tough." Keith says, "Don't worry, we could take care of this." So we go up there, and unfortunately for the guys that had stolen my bike and beat me up, they were downstairs where you change your clothes to go swimming at Franklin Park. Keith walks in there, and he wasn't really nice, as I recall. "That bike will be back here in about 2 minutes." And one of the guys, Bob Love, who ended up being a pretty harsh criminal, said something to Keith. Shouldn't have said it, because Keith knocked him right on his can. I mean, he had him, this poor guy's bleeding. All three of them are leaving. Never had any more trouble at Franklin Park. Nobody stole my bike. I could be as big a mouth as I wanted to. So I would say 12. And they were huge then. They were tough. And Michael talking about them fighting. I can remember sitting in the living room with Mom and Dad. And it would be very quiet, and then all of a sudden, some furniture would move, like a bed would get flipped over, and Dad would be going upstairs. They could fight for 10 minutes and not make a sound. And then all of a sudden, you would hear them, and my dad would say, "This is not good," and up he would go, flying up the stairs into their bedroom. Same thing with what he said to Michael. What in the world is going on? Then I think it was, I don't remember, was Keith or Craig said something uncalled for. Dad popped him with his left hand, which he was good at. He would poke you in the chest with his right hand, and he'd pop you with his left hand, a slap. He had to be a pretty tough father with those two big Jamokes and I. I think of all the people that used to, Mom worked at Lindbergh's, and I think of the people, my dear Aunt Myrna, or Cousin Myrna, would come over and babysit. That poor woman had to try and keep track of all three of us boys. It was a challenge. The other thing I'd like to say, and like I said, I'll write down some thoughts about him, but my brother Keith was a tough man. Physically tough, strong, but he also had a heart of gold. He was probably one of the softer people that I know. And I've always felt through my life that regardless of whatever happened, I had two twin brothers that were my backups. And if the chips were down, I would go to Keith, and we'd work through whatever had to happen, okay? He'd get mad at me. Oh, he'd get so mad at me. But he was always there, supportive, and I always knew he was there. And the cool thing was, when I did something that was wrong, and I was looking for somebody to confirm that it was okay, he would be there, but he'd say, "You stooge, you shouldn't have done this. What were you thinking?" So I've lost my protector. I think I'm part of the problem I'm having is I'm trying to think of things about Keith, but you have to think of them as a pair. They were each other. I can remember one time Keith and I are out playing golf or something, and he's rubbing his chest. And I said, "What in the heck are you doing? You all right?" He said, "Yeah." He said, "But I think maybe something's wrong with Craig." Okay, Craig's in Texas. We get home from playing golf, the phone rings. Keith says, "Well, Craig's in the hospital. He had a heart attack." And I said to him at that point, I said, "Do you get these feelings very often?" I'm thinking, he's nuts. But he says, "Yeah, Doug," he said, "there's many times when Craig is very sorry or sorrowful." He said, "My mood changes." So it's hard to think of them separately, and I think I will write about my big brothers, and I think it's a terribly unique relationship. And those two guys, you want to talk about a bond, that was an amazing bond, okay? And they took care of each other going through life. I can remember living on Bates Street. Craig, every Saturday, had like 10 people whose cars he washed, and he was a fanatic about it, and I think that stayed the way the rest of his life. But then Mom and Dad had an old Plymouth. And the last thing Craig did was, after everybody else's cars were cleaned, he would clean that Plymouth up. And he was cleaning it up to go to church, so Mom and Dad could take it to church. And then in his mind, he had a date that night, and he was going to take that car. Lo and behold, he goes in to get cleaned up. There goes Keith. He's got the keys. He's going to his date. Craig would be so mad. But I think I stand up here all day and talk, but I think the thing that I will remember most and will remember for the rest of my life was Keith's faith in God. After I heard that he had passed, obviously I'm shaking my head, first of all. And then somebody sent a picture out from about, I would guess, 20 years ago, of Keith and Craig standing in my parents' backyard. And it dawned on me, and I absolutely know where Keith is and I know where Craig is, that they were having a heck of a party and I wasn't getting there. I got to wait my time. And I can hear Craig saying to Keith, "You have always been late." Craig was born first. He said, "I've been waiting my whole life for you. It's about time you got up here." So that's the thought I'm having right now.
Well, Penny said they're probably playing cribbage.
Yeah, and Grandpa. And yeah. Either that or they might be playing setback with Grandpa Bart. We always did that for years. And it was kind of a rite of passage when you got to play setback with them. With my grandpa, he came over to my house one time to play cribbage and have dinner. And we had a little poodle. And that poodle got my grandpa's, he would be rubbing it in his pocket. That poodle got that rabbit foot out of my grandpa's pocket and chewed it all up. He was devastated. Anyway, thank you.
Thanks, Doug.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Linda, and I am and was Keith's wife. And what I have to tell you is I was brought into this family late, and so I don't have a lot of that history that you all experienced. But I'll tell you this, this family is unique. The family I came from is nothing like this family. Really a surprise, and a wonderful surprise. All the people that I've met, all the relatives, awesome. When we first met, he introduced me to a lot of his friends. Whenever we were out in the city, he would say, well, I went to school with that guy, and oh yeah, we used to live over there, and those people went to church where I went to church. And I thought to myself, is there anybody who wasn't in your life? Anybody you didn't know? Everywhere we went, there was somebody he went to school with or he worked with. And it opened my eyes because I was from a small city. I came from Cadillac. And I didn't experience that because I went to school in another city. So that was brand new to me, but it was good to see. And he would tell me all about his friends, who they were, how they met. It was wonderful. He did a lot of different things when he was young and up until he became a man. A lot of different jobs that he absolutely loved, especially in the food service. And he sold cars, used cars, I guess, and he managed restaurants. It was just incredible. I mean, he had a great history. We spent so many years traveling. We went so many different places together. It was wonderful of him to include me in his business trips. I met so many different people. It was just incredible, something I'm so glad to have experienced and that I can think back on. So many wonderful things. And I want you guys to know I loved your dad so much, and he loved me. The last year has been really hard, but every day he'd get on his walker and away we would go. We'd load it in the car and we'd go someplace, whether it was to a doctor's office or to just drive around. So he made the most of what he could the last year, and I'm so glad to have experienced that with him too. Thank you.
more sickness, no more pain, no more parting over there, but forever I will be with the one who died for me. What a day, glorious day that will be.
We shouldn't have played that song before I spoke. I know I did. I regret things pretty easily, quickly. Well, good morning. My name is Kirk Bart. I'm Keith Bart's son and proud to be. Thank you for everyone who spoke. And even after me, if you would like to share, please do. I just want to thank you all for being here, and I wish that we could have a big celebration. I know Dad would want that, and with these restrictions and due to the pandemic, then we will have a celebration of his life at a later point, maybe next summer or whenever this passes. So that's something to look forward to, and you may leave today thinking, I guess I wish I would have said, or I remember this, or whatever, and that's okay. There'll be another chance, and you can always call or text me, too. I'll write it down. I just, again, just want to start off by thanking you for being here, for being a part of his life. And I really want you to know, everybody here and Todd and Penny watching and others, that he loved. He loved you. I knew it. He told me often, and I could see it in his behaviors. He loved you dearly. All right. So we're here today to honor my father and celebrate his life. Dad was my best friend. Maybe we need an intermission here before we play another song here, Kevin. I've got a few pages here, but I'll make this quick. I'll pull it together. But Dad was my best friend. We had a very special bond, and a very close relationship where we discussed everything. And I'm grateful for that. I'm very proud of my dad and who he was. Not for everything he did, but for who he was. He had his faults. He had mistakes. He even did some pretty bad things. I sure have. I think we all have. I think we're fallen. We live in a fallen world. Doesn't make it right, doesn't make it okay. But it's part of this fallen world we live in. I also want to let you know that for those things and those mistakes that he and I spent a lot of time talking, mushroom hunting, deer hunting, driving in the car, multi-level marketing meetings, driving to Cabela's in Detroit, Dundee, before they were here. And we talked a lot, and he regretted those things. He regretted each of them, and he told me so in those times over the years, and I'm grateful. And amidst the truth and reality we all face in this fallen world and with our sinful flesh and the enemy of Satan, Dad fought. As Uncle Doug said, he was a tough guy, and he fought. And he fought that spiritual battle the way the Bible instructs. Not perfectly, but he fought to the best of his ability. As a result, he modeled for me. Now, granted, I'm the third born, so, and I was a little behind. I think Mom finally told me I was a mistake, but that's okay. No, Kim's saying no. She told me so. So she finally admitted before. But anyways, that's okay. It's fine. I'm glad I'm here. So God overruled that one, I guess. But anyways, but I was fortunate enough to have the opportunity to, as a result of his fighting that good fight, that he modeled for me the strong characteristics of who he was, and also probably the biggest thing is to learn and to grow, and that personal growth, and to never stop getting better, and to improve myself, to learn and grow, to become more and more like Christ, to be a better version of myself today than I was yesterday. And grace be to God that I learned that through him. He was very real with me, as I mentioned, and Dad did all of this learning and growing. He chose that hard road of change, and he became better and better as life went on. And I'm so grateful that I could witness that, and because of that, I have been able to get better and better, and I'm not done. I'm really grateful for all the things that have been said today. And, you know, Kevin, I forgot about the orange and the orange cream. I don't know how I could forget that. And it was just orange everything, you know. If he wasn't even hungry, he didn't want a thing, and you said orange, and he would have some. And so, you know, he had many characteristics and traits, so many that I thought I could just simply share my list. And I think that you'll know what I mean. These aren't in any particular order. These are just kind of jot down. And one of the things is, and this isn't all inclusive because I'm sure I'm forgetting something in the struggle of this, of him leaving. But he lit up the room with his personality and his smile. And I've been fortunate in the last couple of days to have realize that I have some of that. You know, sometimes you just don't realize some of that stuff. And I've had even people that work for me that have said that. They said, you're just like your dad because you light up the room. You have a smile. You have a personality that is large, and I'm grateful. He had a very commanding presence. He was funny. He was very hospitable. He loved serving others and wanted everything to be just right. He wanted everything to be just right for them. And I say that because he told me so, but also I'm that way. When the pressure's on, I'm not always the funnest person to be around. And Jamie's learning, like, just, okay, I'm just going to ignore him for a little bit. He'll come back together. And, that's kind of how he was. But it was because he wanted that end result to be so filling and satisfying for those that he was serving. Dad was very compassionate to the plights of others. I think of him often talking about just difficulties of all of us, thinking about praying for, and all of those friends who aren't here, of course, and family members, and those that may even be listening. Dad was classy. He was, my opinion, He was clean cut and a good dresser. He taught me about shiny shoes and being clean cut. I've never had a piercing. Not that there's anything wrong with that. I've never had a tattoo. And it's because of that. And that's okay. It's okay if you have them. But, you know, that real clean cut, that's he felt that was important. He was very driven and self-motivated. He taught me to do it despite how you feel. He taught me that if you're going to do something, to do it right, you know? And that really is just, those are things that'll carry generations. He was generous. He was always quick to give. In his daily life, as he had resources, he would give freely. I think about his friends and family, and I know his kids that he and Linda took to Hawaii, very generous, and I know there were many others that you did as well. He was an optimist. He was always positive, even in the darkest situations. Dad loved Uncle Craig. They did have that special bond. And he, what I really want to say about that actually with Uncle Craig is that he really missed Uncle Craig. And he talked about him often. And Dad loved God, and he was a believer. He pursued the relationship with God, and he loved reading books and devotionals, especially Max Lucado and many other Christian books, and listening to sermons on TV and the Christian concerts of Gaither, right? As we've heard some of those songs here. So, and I should have looked at Linda when I said that, because I don't, it'd probably take the rest of your life to get those things out of your mind. I'm sure they were blaring on the TV all the time. Dad was known to occasionally share his opinion on things. Okay, who are we kidding, right? He couldn't help himself. He really couldn't. That can be a strength or a weakness, I suppose, depending on the environment. And I think, Linda, you were very good for him. And one of the things I respect most about you, Linda, is that you don't share your opinion unless you're asked. And I will tell you, that's foreign to me, even since I've known you. Right or wrong, that's what we struggle with, but you were very good for him with that. And I think that really helped him with those things too. Dad loved each of you, truly. Please know that. Everyone in this room and those watching, he loved you dearly, period. There's no doubt. Dad was consistently grateful for Linda. Consistently. He would always say, I'm so thankful for Linda. And he was so thankful to be married to you. And he loved you. I agree. You said that you loved him, and I know you did. And he loved you. And I never heard him say anything negative about you. Ever. Some of Dad's favorite things and the activities. Eating. I thought that was funnier. But sorry about that, Dad. Dad used to tell me, he'd say, you know, at my funeral, this was years ago, but at my funeral, you know, tell him I enjoyed the food I ate. I enjoyed it. And then he was, you know, working on his weight. And he said, no, don't say that. That's not it. But, you know, he did. And I do. And it's okay. And he loved to cook. And he was a very good cook. He, you know, again, Fables, the burgers and the food there. And side note that when I remember being a young kid when Fables was around, and I was always kind of felt a little embarrassed because we go up to that counter and he would say, no, don't press on that burger. You're squeezing all the juice out. And then he would ask for a big tub of mayonnaise so that he could mix ketchup with it, and then he'd dip his fries in that. And, well, we all would, and it was delicious. But I remember every time he asked, they looked at him like, what? What are you asking for? It's funny. His Sunday roast dinners, you know, growing up, we certainly remember those. As Kevin mentioned, his gravy. I think of omelets. And when we were deer hunting, I'm sure Daryl remembers that. We had some great meals up north. That was after the Helmer trip. And you guys realized, well, we could make our own meals. We don't have to have TV dinners here. And it really worked out beautifully. For me, anyways, third born, there's a perk. He loved produce. loved going to the Fulton Street Farmers Market, getting to know those folks down there and enjoying good produce, apples and corn, and he knew the places to get them. You know, you don't go to that vendor, you go to that one. And, you know, he'd drive all the way out, even as of this past summer, he'd drive all the way out to Virgin's, way out almost to their old house, and buy corn from a particular farmer because he thought it was the best, and it was. Of course, his homemade cocktail shrimp and cocktail sauce, his Cajun shrimp boil, and the shrimp cookouts. He always used to say, salesmen are the easiest to sell. And he would be real quick to buy things. He'd see infomercials, or he would, you know, I only don't want to know how many Gaither albums he bought or whatever, but, you know, those kind of things. He always said that the salesmen are the easiest to sell, and has always wanted to have the newest gadget or the latest thing. Loved listening to Christian music concerts on TV, again, the Gaithers, and side note, I do too now. He loves Cowboys and Indians. We collected baseball cards for a lot of years, and a lot of good memories that I had with that too, and still have them, and I'm grateful for that. Dad was, and I'm wrapping up here, but he got so excited about, and he would anticipate things, such as spending time with others. He just loved people. It motivated him, whether it was coffee with friends, family gatherings. And, you know, at least in, I think if you're Seinfeld fans, the popover, I think Dad mastered that. He would, pop over to our house quite often and inopportune times, and Linda's nodding her head, and he'd, you know, we'd say, well, we're getting together at noon for lunch, and he'd be there at 11:30, and Linda's like, I'm sorry, we're early, I'm sorry, you know. So I never did have to get to the point where I gave him 30 minutes later, but that would have been a strategy. So he loved people, and he loved being with people, spending quality time with his brothers and their families, with his kids, with his grandchildren and his great-grandchildren. I have great memories from our deer hunting trips with, you know, including Uncle Doug and even Kevin and Daryl, and perch and walleye fishing, especially perch. We used to fish off the piers as often as we could. That's when perch fishing was good back then. And ice fishing too, and morel mushroom hunting, boxing, loved big events and going to the Golden Gloves, playing cards, setback, cribbage with family. He really loved doing that with Linda. And I know you played other games too, but really just loved that. He enjoyed traveling with Linda, many work trips around the world, many trips to Hawaii with Linda and family and friends, going out to Arizona, and boy, did he like the saguaro cacti. And, you know, these are all things that, it's where I get my love for these things too, and I think many of us do, and I'm grateful for him. These are traditions, and these are behaviors that I and we have the opportunity to pass down for generations. Dad had my back. I think that was the biggest thing that came to my mind. And just like what Uncle Doug had shared about having his back, he was a natural at it. And he would scold me over the wrong. And I'm glad he did. He never excused it, never said it was okay. But he realized that you couldn't turn back the clock. But you could make it right. And he had a very loving response, and I won't get into the details because this isn't about me, but I gave him plenty of examples to exercise that. I feel so grateful to have had as much time with my father as I did, and all that I have learned from him. I absolutely cherish the memories I have with my dad. He was a good man and a great father to me. I have no regrets in my relationship with him, because if we did have regrets, we made him right. And I will miss him so much. I miss him so much already. And I will forever remember all the things I've shared today and all the things that are to come. I'm very proud that he was my dad. I was proud of him. I don't know how long it will take me to grieve this tremendous loss, and that's not really important, I guess. It'll come. But he was my best friend and one of the most important people in my life. Certainly one of the few in my inner circle. I feel heartbroken to no longer have him here with us. But I know that his memory lives through us and will forever carry on. And we will have the rest of our lives to reminisce. And I look forward to that. And I thank you for listening. And thank you again for being here.
Thank you, everyone. Let me, Kevin and I talked about this. I'll just share a couple brief things, and then we'll pray and close the service for the day. But in the spirit of kind of thinking about our story in the bigger story of the Bible, there was something in Scripture that's been recorded in the Bible written directly to those of us experiencing a day like this. And it's from one of the very earliest letters in the New Testament written chronologically. That's 1 Thessalonians. And I'm going to read the passage to you in a second, but what was going on there was people in the church had heard Jesus' promises that he was going to come back really soon, but then people in their church began to die. And people in the church would get together just like this, and they kind of went, what do we do with this? You know, how Jesus made these promises to us, but this person we love has now died to this life. Like, how are we supposed to think about that? And the Apostle Paul wrote this to address that very feeling, that very issue in people when they had lost someone that they loved to this life. So listen to this, would you? Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. And when you, for me, it's a huge thing to understand the context of that, because he wrote that to people in the exact same place as we are right now. Like, what do you really, as a Christian, what do you think about death? Because there's no getting around it on a day like this, right? There's no acting like it's not real. There's no kind of putting it to the back of your mind thinking it's way out there somewhere. I mean, death to this life is very real. But the hope we have as Christians is not a cliche kind of thing. We actually believe that Jesus died and rose again and is actually alive right now. And he promised to go before us and prepare a place for us. And he also promised to come back to take us to be with him where he is. And again, this is not a faint hope. This is the foundation of what Christians believe. So as Christians, we don't just throw out that, well, we hope he's in a better place kind of thing. We know that people who've been united with Christ by faith return to God fully and finally when they die to this life. So that's the big picture, right? Of all of you gathered here, I think I know the Kevin Bart family best. And Kevin and I were chatting a little bit. I did not know really personally your husband, your brother, your dad. But Kevin did share that there were some difficult things from his past that made him very thankful for his salvation. And that immediately brought to mind the story, the background story of the song Amazing Grace. I don't know if you know this. It was written by a guy named John Newton. He lived in the 1700s, died in 1807, but he was the captain of a slave trading ship. He had some difficult things in his past, but he came to faith in Christ later in life and wrote these words about the salvation he experienced. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. The Lord has promised good to me. His word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace that brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. When we've been there 10,000 years bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we'd first begun. Amazing grace. Would you pray with me? God, we worship you and we thank you for the life of Keith Bart. Thank you for the person you made him to be by nature and by your grace. I thank you for the amazing grace that you extended to him. Thank you for the amazing grace that you extend to us all. God, turn our hearts toward you. Help us look to you and trust you as we remember and as we grieve. In Christ, we do not grieve as those who have no hope. We do grieve. It's just that we do that with hope. So God, be with Keith's family in that. Oh, we love you, Lord. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. friends, it is in the sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life that we commit to God, Keith Bart. Would you pray with me? Father, in our mind's eye, we lift Keith to you in the palm of our hand and release him to you. Finally and fully. And together we acknowledge, Lord Jesus, that there is no one to whom we would rather trust him than you. For you are the one you claimed to be. A good, good Father, a loving God, and a faithful Savior. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your faithfulness to us. Thank you for your faithfulness to Keith. We pray in your name, Lord. Amen. If you're able, would you please stand? And friends, as we go from this place, believe in your hearts the good news of the Bible again. We live in a world where a resurrection has happened. That's not a kinda. That's a for real. On this day, that makes all the difference. So may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. And then may the Lord turn his face toward you and grant you his peace. In the name of Jesus, amen.